Welcome to the Needlebug. My name is Karen, and if you are new here, welcome. I am so glad you clicked on the channel to give this channel a chance. If you are a returning subscriber, thank you so, so much for coming back and hanging out with me through all the crazies and the bloopers and, well, you guys know. And lastly, to my VIP members, thank you so ever much for all your support and all your encouragement to keep this channel going. You don't know how much I appreciate it. This is a channel where I share my knowledge of needlework. I've been a stitcher for, the best part of 50 plus years. So there's a lot of things that I have learned over the years that I can share with you. I especially do cross-stitch, full coverage, with a little bit of hardanger thrown in, and some tips and tricks and life updates and whatever else happens along the way. So today we are here to finish up the Mary Wickham's Quaker Sampler. Okay, blooper number one already on the books. Mary Hickmont Hardanger Sampler. I have this corner to finish, and then I have one more corner to do, and my sampler will be finished. So I am here today to record the finish with you, and we can chat a little bit and just hang out until I finish it. So I should have started a new thread before I started this video, because this one is now finished. So I'm gonna flip this over. I have it on my Potoki stand. So I am going to flip this over and end this thread so I can start a new one. And that will finish this, hopefully my new thread will finish this corner. I'll tell you what, these little cable stitches can be real stinkers to get your needle under to end off. So we're gonna go over here in the block a little bit and put some stitches in there to end it. There we go. Yeah, they can be stinkers. If you are new to Hardanger, you are most certainly welcome. I have a series posted on the channel called Let's Learn the Basics of Hardanger. I've had quite a bit of interest in it, and quite a few people have done very well with it. So that is something that, if you're interested in, that's out there for you. Please feel free to check it out. And as I always say, 2, 3, 4. If you have questions on how to do something, how to do a certain stitch, or just anything, feel free to shoot me a message or an email, and I will be more than happy to help you out with it. In fact, I just had a gal the other day who knew she had a mistake but couldn't find it, and her counting was off. I guess it would help if I put these there. That's better. I had to put my magnifier down. She had a counting mistake, and she could not find it. So together, we figured out, I have to do this just a little bit down further for me to see. Together, we figured out where her mistake was. She fixed that one. And in the process of fixing that one, she found yet another one, which she then fixed, so she was good to go. But all that took was, and I encourage people, if you have a problem, to don't hesitate. All it took was take a picture of it. Send me the picture. I'll take a look at it. We'll see if we can find your mistake. In a lot of cases, if you turn your piece to the back, you can oftentimes find the mistake much easier than if you try and find it from the front. The stitches are a bit more defined on the back, and I don't know, it's just easier to find, especially if it's a counting error. If you flip it over, you can see it much, much easier. So that's just a little hint for those of you that are looking for, oops, I counted wrong. Or did I count wrong? I'm going to sneak right in here because I think I missed that hole. So we're going to just catch it up right now. There we go. And this gets a four-sided stitch around it. Not a four-sided stitch, what am I saying? A double cable stitch around it. So this stitch, some people go, oh my goodness, but it really is not that hard. The easiest thing to remember is I'm coming up in this hole. I want to go down two threads away from this last stitch. So I'll go down here. Then I can come up in the bottom of this stitch, two threads away. Now I have to turn a corner, so I'm going to come up two threads away from this to this side. I'm going to go back down here in the top. I'm going to come up here. Hopefully you're seeing this. Oh, oops. Sorry, I oofed my... See if I can get you, bring you in just a smidgen closer. Ooh, that's a little better, isn't it? Now you can see better. Okay, so we're going to come up there. It doesn't help that this is blowing out the color of my... Trying to turn my light down a little bit here. Of my fabric, which is making the thread a little hard to see. But you're going to go down in that corner. Now on this side, it's a little bit different because as you can see here, these end ones, you don't actually complete the whole point. So we're gonna go here and here. And that's the last stitch on that side. Come up here, go to the point. Turn the corner. Go here. In here. Come up here in the corner. Okay, nothing going on back there. Here, turn the corner again. That's the one thing with these doing this cable stitch around around eyelets. It's a lot of corner turning. Okay, now I'm going to use this same thread, but I'm going to scooch out here to the very corner where we're going to do some let me run my thread under out there. Now, if this was going to be something that was going to sit out and have the back exposed, I would not carry my thread like this, but I'm going to make this into a clutch, like a little purse clutch type thing with a lining, so that is not going to be an issue. But normally I would have ended the thread and restarted. So now we are going to do a double cable stitch here. So we're going to go 1, 2, 1, 2. And then we're going to come back up here. 1, 2. Come up here. Do you see how I always am coming up in the bottom of the previous stitch and then going down two threads over from the stitch that I just did. So here's two threads over. Two threads over, bottom of the previous stitch, two threads. I mean, that's just how I found it to be the easiest way for me. And I believe most of the diagrams that I've seen, that is the way it's supposed to be done. And those of you who are really loving Hardanger, let me give a little plug for Yvette Stanton's new book. On filling stitches. She's taking, there are quite a few places that have pre-orders. Okay, I gotta look here. I think I'm off by a stitch, a thread. I am. Hold on, I'll be back with you. Oh, there you go. There, there. Okay, the frog has come to visit, my friends. real life here. Real life. I just had to get a different angle. It was a little high for me to see. I think I see where it was an error. So let's try this one more time. All right, let's make sure. It's not going to be affected by anything, so I guess if I really, really would have wanted to, I could have left it, but 1, 2, 3, if that just would not have, 2, that just would not have sat very well. Oh, I see what I did. Oh. 1, 2, 3. That was the mistake. I started one thread over too far. Okay. On this sampler, a lot of things line up with the middle of the four-sided stitch. So if you are in the middle, you would have two threads on each side of your needle. That's where I was started over one thread too far. Now, let's do this again. So that is another point where you can always check. It's going to line up with the cable stitches here, and it's going to line up with the four-sided stitch. So you have lots of places to confirm that you are in the right spot. And don't do as I did, where get all the way down this row of stitches to realize, oops, I did it wrong. But then again, I'm not surprised that I did it wrong. There was one block, and I forget exactly which one it was, that I frogged several times. Several. And when I say several, I mean more than twice. Yeah. 4 or 5 times until I got it right. I was just having one of those days where I think I totally forgot how to count. But for those of you that are, you know, sitting on the fence about whether you want to try this or not, I'm going to say, give it a shot. What it is just a lot of simple stitches put together, and it just makes something that looks so wonderful. I mean, seriously, you think about, what am I doing here? Well, basically, I'm just doing a running stitch on 2 side-by-side lines. I'm making them, I'm doing it, instead of going down one and coming back up, I'm making them sit aside of each other, okay? Well, that's not hard. Those of you who stitch samplers should certainly have done many kinds of eyelets over the time that you've been stitching. And your cluster blocks are just satin stitches. So I would think that you've probably done satin stitches somewhere along the line, especially people that have done needlepoint or Bargello. That's made up of satin stitches. So it's, that's all it is. If you've done a sampler with specialty stitches, this is just a four-sided stitch. Very easy to follow. Very easy to do. You know, and I'm going to say, I have always, until recently, highly recommended Janice Love's. 2, 3, 4. Hardanger books to learn how to do this. But I have since reevaluated that. And Janice's books are very good. Don't misunderstand. I have Janice's books. I taught myself with Janice's books. However, my new best favorite books to learn Hardanger are Yvette Stanton's books. I cannot recommend them enough. I highly recommend them. The text is wonderful. The pictures are, oh, so good. It is just like the pictures show each step of how to complete the stitch. The diagrams are so well done. In fact, Yvette, if you watch these, I wish I knew what software you use to do those. Because I'm writing directions for, or I'd like to write directions for a piece that I'm working on. And I just am having trouble doing pictures. But I will get it figured out. No, wait, I did something wrong there. Hold the phone. And hopefully my husband will not be over here with the mower. I hear it running outside. And hopefully I'll be able to get this finished before he gets to this side of the house with the riding mower, because it does then get a little bit noisy. There. And now this one. And the last stitch here. And now this one. So that is that corner finished. Now, just for time purposes, I am just going to park my thread up there and I will finish it off later. And we will move down to the final corner. So you guys get to help me finish. And I have directions from a very sweet friend who is one of my VIP members. I had a pretty good idea of how to make this into the I guess what do I want to call it? A clutch purse. I had an idea how I wanted to do it. But Missy, thank you so, so very much if you're watching this. Missy sent me how she would work it, directions, of which I very, very much appreciated. And yes, I did understand them perfectly. So that is probably 2, 3, 4. The method I will be using to finish this into its final product. Oh no, I want to go this way. That is my plan anyway. I have a piece of fabric here that I plan on using. It's from my stash that I've had, and it will not be exposed other than through a little bit of the cut work. So it will just strictly be a lining. So Missy, I did have one question if you're watching this. I'm thinking just to give it a little more body, I have enough, a big enough piece that I could fold that fabric in half. Yes, I could fold that fabric in half to give it a little bit more body, and then still do everything that you recommended. Oh, wait a minute. I went in the wrong hole. This is a little bit out of my line of vision. I think I can manage it that way. I did think about putting a little, but I didn't want to. I thought about putting a little bit of Pellon in to, you know, make it not so quite so floppy, but I didn't want to put that right against the stitching. So I think if I double the lining fabric, like just fold it in half, that would give it enough body so that it wouldn't be quite so, I don't know, for lack of a better word, floppy. So I'm going to try that, because I am going to do like my friend Missy suggested, is put the wrong sides together, put a hem in this, or set it up for a hem, put the wrong sides together, and then I'm going to hand sew the lining to the hard anchor piece. And that way I don't even have to turn anything inside out. And then run a buttonhole stitch around the whole thing. Except what would be the bottom. But up both sides across the flap that would fold down, and across the inner edge of what would be the pocket of the purse. So that's my plan. So I would be interested for those of you that are working on this, how are you going to finish yours? Oh, wait, what did I do here? Hold on, hold on. Wait, get my bearings here. Okay, get those threads out of the way. Get out of my way here. There we go. Now that's more. So I would be interested. Put it in the comments. How do you plan on finishing your piece? Okay, why does that not look right? Because it's not. See, this happens to me when I I want to record something. Okay, one, two, one. Okay, needed to go out one more here. How many of you are hollering at me that I did not count correctly? And I didn't hear you. So, one, two. There we go. Now, two, turn a corner. Two, in the corner. One, okay. This one goes the center. Oh, that's right on the line. Okay. And now we're going to go down this side because remember, this gets a point, but that kind of ends abruptly. Tell you, some days these little mag eyes are not mag, well, the clip-on magnifiers are just not cutting it. And this is 32 count. And some days it's like I think I need something else. Now, if you watched my video that I posted yesterday, I can't remember if I talked about it in there, but this is a good opportunity to ask, do any of you folks use the Craft Optics, the magnif— oh, for heaven's sake, Karen, that's wrong. They're rather pricey, but they look like got my sequence all goofed up here. They look like jeweler's loops. Well, no, they're not, but they look like little binoculars that are already affixed to a pair of glasses. And they, they put your prescription in the glasses if you have a prescription. And then they put these magnifiers on. And I was talking to a woman at the retreat that I was at this weekend, and she has a pair. And she, like I, stitches every day. And she loves them. But as I said, they are not the cheapest things in the world. So I just wonder if, or I'm just wanting to inquire if any of you folks out there use them. And if you do, how do you like them? Like, my main motivation for asking that is, are they worth the amount of money that you have to spend to get them? Because, like I said, they are expensive. And if you get them with a light already attached, they're even quite a bit more expensive than if you get them without the light. So, I mean, I'm talking, not to scare people, but I'm talking, they are several hundred dollars. But, okay, my infamous but. And my husband's outside mowing, so please excuse the mowing sounds. He should be finished directly. In fact, no, he's turning around. If they help you to see, and they work very well, and being somebody who, I stitch every day, people, every day, with the very, very rare exceptions. Okay, I don't have a lot of finishes because I stitch these big, humongous projects, but I do stitch every day. And if a day goes by that a needle is not in my hand, I get a little grumpy. So, for something like this, can you tell I'm trying to convince myself that I need to spend $500? Yeah, they're $500 plus. Plus a smidge. I said, for somebody who stitches all the time, I mean, when I'm not doing things that I need to do, there is a needle of some sort in my hand. Or, I am working on coming up with a piece to do another. I'm undecided if it's going to be just a stitch along or if it's going to be another how to do. Let's learn some stitches. But that's another discussion. But, you know, if I'm not doing things like that, I'm stitching all the time. Now, yes, I have these clip-on things. Yes, I have a Daeswar lamp for those of you that know what they are. And it really, the easiest way to explain it, it's just like the magnifying lamps you see in your doctor's office. However, the viewing area is very, very small on it. For me, anyway, given the things that I stitch. It's very small, and the magnifier part itself is a fairly decent round size, except the center is very good. But the closer you get to the outside, the more distorted what you're looking at gets, because it's kind of concave. So it's just for what I want to do, or what I do, just not really working. I can't get it positioned so that I can see decently with it. So I really, wish I would have gotten a different shaped magnifier on it. Okay, which I could still do. However, that being said, to buy a different, like the square, they come in an elongated square or a different shaped one, would probably, I haven't priced it, but the last time I did, would cost me just as much as these glasses would. And then I could only use it right here in my craft room. Okay, can you see I'm rationalizing? I can hear you probably yelling at me to, oh, Karen, just do it. they would not, you know, your Daeswar is not portable. And where I go, my stitching goes. So if I go to an appointment and I know I have to wait, my stitching goes with me. When my husband goes for his surgery in 2.5-3 weeks, whatever that turns out, the 6th of July, I know I'm going to be sitting there for quite some time. My stitching goes with me. I will be staying over at my daughter's that night because he will be able to come home the next day. My stitching goes with me. My Daeswar goes nowhere but beside my chair. So, I really am thinking about it. I figure I have an appointment with the eye doctor. I think it's mid-July. don't know, it's in July sometime. So I'm kind of thinking that do my eye doctor appointment, see if my prescription changes, get a copy of my prescription, and then go for it. And I know you're probably saying, well, ask your eye doctor to make you glasses for stitching. Well, this is a new, this, if those of you that have been around for a while probably remember I had trouble with my eyes, and the eye doctor I was going to had my prescription all kerfluffled. So this is a new eye doctor who I have really only seen the one time. And when I questioned about that, he did not seem real perceptive or receptive to making me glasses just for stitching. Hence the other reason that I thought, well, maybe these craft optics might not be a bad idea. So, okay, ladies and gentlemen, I think I have myself kind of, sort of, convinced that is what I need to do. You know, things are only, sometimes I think, things are only as good as the tools you use. And if you have visual trouble and you need magnification, then get yourself, oh no, wait, that's not. See, here I'm rationalizing again. Get yourself good magnification that's going to help you do what you need to do. So, I think I have myself convinced, but I'm still interested in hearing if any one of you use them and how you like them. You know, I have one person that has told me she loves them. They were worth every penny. That's one person. And I am interested in hearing from anybody else who uses them to see if they feel the same way. So, any input would be much, much appreciated. Okay, now the eyelets are done. Now, I just have that little bit of, I'm going to end that off later. Yes, I'm wasting some thread, but I want to start a new one to do to do the double cable. That way I won't have to change my thread in the middle of it, because sometimes, yeah, these threads I will end off. I'm going to start my thread down here so that I can stitch over it. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so I'm leaving a little bitty tail. Gonna try and catch that tail as I work down this row. I don't know why, but I really do enjoy doing this double cable stitch. Now, normally I would do it as a sewing method, but I have it in a hoop so that you folks can see what I'm doing. And to be perfectly honest, I have always, did I get my hole there? Yeah. I have the majority of the time always done hardanger in hand. Like, I don't normally put it in a hoop or a Q-snap, or I even saw somewhere, it might have been a Facebook group, a woman did this beautiful, beautiful tablecloth. And I do have that book on order. It should be here sometime mid-July. Oh my God, it's an outstanding tablecloth. And she had it on a scroll frame. Now, I have never done it that way. Not to say that you can't, because obviously you most certainly can. But I am kind of feeling like having it in a small hoop, my stitches are looking a bit, I think they look better. So I may continue using a small hoop. The thing that scares me about a scroll frame is, and again, if anybody watching this knows for sure, but the way I was learned by talking to people is that you don't want that tight tension on your piece when you're cutting, when you're doing the cut work. So I would think, and correct me if I'm wrong, those that use scroll frames would loosen it up to do any cutting, I would think. Or people that put it in a Q-snap, I would think that you would loosen it or take it out of the Q-snap to do the cutting. But having never done it that way, I can't speak to that because I really don't know. I know how I do it, and that is I just hold it in my hand and cut because when I'm cutting, I'm manipulating the fabric in different directions in order to cut the way I know how to cut. You know, like when I cut these blocks here, I've seen some people like cut one side, cut this side, cut down this side, and then cut here. Well, once you've cut here and here, that leaves these threads flapping all over the place to cut here and here. What I do is I cut opposite each other first. So I will cut here, then I will cut here, then I will go in and cut here. So the only edge I really have floppy threads is this one. Makes it so much easier, I think. But again, that's just me. But that has been my experience through the years that I have been stitching. And as I always say, there is no right way. There is no wrong way. There's only the way that you are comfortable in doing it. So, given all of that, my friends, here we go. Let's move you up here a little bit. Here is down through the fabric, the last stitch. The stitching is done. All I have left to do is cut out the centers of these blocks. I am not going to put dove's eyes in. So once that is cut, this piece is finished. So let me take it out of here. Let me move the stand. Oops. Let me move the stand. Let me move my iPad. I didn't need my iPad, but let me move it. Let me open up my little cloth here that I'm laying this on to show you. Now, you have to ignore the threads that need to be worked in. They will get worked in. But let's take a gander at the whole thing. Let's see if we can get it in the picture. Let's get those threads out of the way. And let's zoom. Look, there it is. Almost. We can get it all in, almost. Can I go a little higher? No, that doesn't show it very well. Okay, what if I do it this way? I will tell that to go away. There we go. Now I can get you just a little bit closer. There we go. Except for the cutting and working those ends in, we are done. So there will be, to this stitch along, one last brief video when I have it put together. I'm just thinking, unless I film my steps of putting it together. There you go. Now you can see it even a bit better. To do that, I would have to like do little segments and then edit and put them all together. And I may just do that so that you can see the steps I took. And the mistakes I make along the way of making it into a clutch. But my plan is that this will get folded like this. Okay, so this will be the pocket. This will have the lining attached, and it will get a finished buttonhole edge along here. Okay, this will have lining attached because this then is going to come down like this. So once the, and this will get trimmed off. Okay, that part I have to work on a little bit. And then once the lining is sewn on, I will do this edge of buttonhole first, because that's an inside edge. Then I will probably start down here, because I'm not going to do buttonhole stitch along there. So I will probably start down here, go all the way up this side, continue on the flap, go across the top, come down this side, continue along here. So that buttonhole stitch is what is going to hold it all together. Now, I did have a thought, and I think Missy suggested this, to actually maybe hand stitch along here before doing the buttonhole stitch, so that they're already attached to each other, and then give it that finished edge with the buttonhole stitch. So that's the plan. So the lining will be attached wrong side to wrong side to the whole piece, okay, to the whole thing. And then it will be, in essence, what will happen is it will be folded the way it should be, stitched in the way it should be, and buttonhole edge to complete it all. So that will probably be the last video in this series. I hope everyone has enjoyed everything. I hope everyone gets their projects completed. And please let me know how you finish yours. Please send me some pictures of your progress or your finish, and I will continue to update a video of all the people that have sent me pictures and have completed the sampler. And yes, it's just been fun. Just been lots of fun. So with that, we're getting a little long here. So with that, I think we are going to call this one a day. I will be back with segments on completing how I put this together. And if I don't get that, I will at least do a short video of the finish, the complete, fully finished object. Okay? So, just remember, my friends, there are no rules in cross stitch. In hardanger, you got a few. So, until next time, I hope you enjoy the rest of your week, and I will see you in the last video of this series. So, bye-bye for now.